Good morning, friends. Today we are going to learn about the laboratory diagnosis of enteric fever, that is the typhoid. So when we are starting the laboratory diagnosis, it starts from the sample. What all samples we can take? That is the blood, serum, bone marrow, urine and stool. So blood culture is the gold standard technique for diagnosing the case of typhoid. And it is very useful in the first week of fever once the patient is getting the symptom of fever. So in the first week of getting the this symptom, at that time there is very much chance that blood culture can come positive. And later on, the chances of detecting this bacteria in the blood comes down. So first week mein maximum chance hai isolating the bacteria. Then conventional method se bhi you can diagnose, or automated method like BACTEC can be used. In conventional, brain heart infusion broth is being used, where the anticoagulant is there, sodium polyanethol sulfonate, and the blood is taken in the blood to this ratio, blood to the this broth ratio is being taken as 1:5 to 1:10. So once the blood sample has been added to the broth, then it has to be, once it reached to the lab, so it has to be incubated at 37 degrees Celsius for 24 hours. And then on the next day after the incubation, then we will do the subcultures on the plates like blood agar, this McConkey agar or chocolate agar. Then second comes the biphasic media, that is the biphasic media means we have there is solid as well as liquid media in the same culture bottle. So because when we are doing in this conventional method like brain heart infusion broth, so repeated subculture you have to open the bottle and then do the plating on the these medias. So in this, within the bottle both the medias are there, and you can do the subculture simultaneously on the solid media also. So that is the advantage of biphasic media. This is a very important Viva question also, and can be asked anywhere in the spotting or in the Viva questions. And what is the advantage? That is because you are not opening the bottle again and again for doing the subculture. Because ideally when we are doing the blood culture, we do subculture if we are not getting the colonies on the plate for 1 week. So, and in certain bacteria, it has to be extended even for 2 weeks or 3 weeks, which are slow growers. So, when we are doing and we have to do a repeated subculture, so there may be chance that the this media may get contaminated. So when it is very useful when we are using for those bacteria where you need repeated subculture for a long time, and it is easy to do. Then the automated like BACTEC, BACTalert. So result come fast in this. Nowadays these are being preferred, and growth is continuously being monitored. And result wise also chance of getting positive result is also high in the automated systems. This you can see the brain heart infusion broth, which is being used in the conventional technique for isolating the bacteria in the blood culture. This is the biphasic media. So you can see liquid and solid media are within the same bottle, and whenever you want to do subculture, you can do subculture on the solid media. Now comes the bone marrow culture. So it is also indicated in the first week of fever, 55 to 90% chances are there you will get positive result if there is infection. It is useful if patient is on antibiotics, because if the patient is already started the antibiotics, the blood culture usually comes negative. So in those patient it is useful. Then the duodenal aspirate. So this sample also you can use in the first week for isolating the salmonella. And if we are using the combination of blood culture, bone marrow culture, duodenal aspirate, then the chances of isolating the bacteria is very high. So it is the best combination in the first week. So when we are diagnosing a case of typhoid, so it has been said that according to weeks of the fever. Suppose this is the first week, so best is the blood culture. But somehow if there is you need the bone marrow, as it is an invasive procedure, bone marrow culture usually not indicated until unless it's very much needed. And in the second week, antibody testing is recommended. And in the third week and fourth week, urine culture and the stool culture is being preferred. So this is how you can easily learn to diagnose a case of typhoid. In first week, blood culture. Second week, antibody testing, like we can have the Vidal test. And in third and fourth week, there is the stool and urine culture. Now comes the stool culture. It is useful in third week of fever. So for those person who are having the infection, having the symptom, third week it is useful. Also those person who are the carriers. Who are carrier? Carrier means they are having the infection but not manifesting the symptom. So to diagnose those carrier also you need the stool culture. And the processing for the stool culture is same as I have discussed in the diarrhea also, how we what are the plates we need for culturing and how we can identify any pathogen in the stool culture. Then when we are processing the stool sample for salmonella, we need our enrichment broth, that is the selenite F broth. What is this enrichment broth? That means there is some nutrition, there is some something important in the broth is there, which will fever, it will fever the growth of this bacteria. So this is like in Vibrio, we have the APW, alkaline peptone water. So similarly, to isolate the salmonella in the stool sample, we need enrichment broth. So we have two options, selenite F we use kar sakte, or we can use the gram negative broth. What are the plates which we can use? That is the XLD. We get pink colonies of this salmonella. We can also use DCA, that is deoxycholocitrate agar, and salmonella shigella agar. You can use any of the one. Then highly selective media, we can use Wilson Blair, Brilliant Greens, bismuth sulfide medium. Then urine culture, it is useful in fourth week of illness, useful to detect carriers. So, kuch mein carrier mein stool mein excretion hota hai bacteria ka, and in some there is excretion of the bacteria in the urine. So, to detect carriers, we have to do stool and urine culture. Chances of isolation as compared to stool sample very poor. And how for processing of urine sample is different. That is because urine is very high in amount. So you have to centrifuge the urine, and the centrifuge part you have to inoculate on the culture medias. Now, once you get the growth on the plate, suppose I am talking about suppose blood culture. We have done blood culture, which is most preferred route of isolating this bacteria. So if we get the colonies on the culture plate, on the blood agar plate, on the McConkie agar plate, so what are the next step we have to do? That is, in any bacteria isolation, we have to do, once we get the growth, then we have to do the culture smear. That is, you have to make a smear and do the gram staining from the culture. So what will you get? That is a gram negative bacilli. The next step is motility. So we do for motility with the hanging drop. So we get the motile bacilli. Then comes the biochemicals. So as this bacteria belongs to the Enterobacteriaceae family, so the members of this family, they are catalase positive, oxidase negative, and they grow on the simple vessel media like nutrient agar, ferment sugars, and reduce nitrate to nitrite. So all these things are shown by the salmonella also, and they belong to the Enterobacteriaceae family. Then once we have known that it is a salmonella, then you have to also do the speciation, as two species are there, Salmonella enterica, Salmonella bongori. So with the help of these biochemicals only, you have to know whether which this species is this. Then you have to also know the subspecies, then the serotypes. So other tests which you do, that is the indole, maximum time it's indole negative, H2S. So typhi, somewhere typhi gives positive, paratyphi B, paratyphi A is negative. So I've already told you in the previous lecture that this typhoid is caused by only three serotypes, that is the somewhere typhi, paratyphi A and paratyphi B. So only three you have to keep in your mind. Then in this TSI we get K by A, that is the alkaline by acid reaction. Then MRVP, MR positive, VP negative. We also go for the decarboxylase test. And to finally know which serotype it is, we have to do the slide agglutination test. So what we do in the slide agglutination test, that is we take the slide and we take a drop of normal saline on it, and then we make a milky suspension of the colony which we get on the plate. So you have made the milky suspension, then you add the according to the zone, like in what zone you are living. So if somewhere typhi is more common there, so you can start serotyping from the somewhere typhi. So somewhere typhi O antigen, that is 9, it comes in the 9 group, O9 group. So you have to add the first, you will check with the polyvalent sera. Then you will go with the specific, that is O9. If it comes with the O9 positive, then you will check for the H and H1 and H2. So that is how we do serotyping. One method is this. Second method is, that is according to your biochemicals. Like from the biochemical reaction, you will know whether it is somewhere typhi, paratyphi A or paratyphi B. So according to that, you can have, or other somewhere, you can have, you can check with the other antiseras. Like if it belongs to somewhere paratyphi A, so depending upon which O group it belongs, so you have to use that O antisera. So that is how it is being decided in the lab. Either you go through the biochemicals, if you are suspecting it is paratyphi A, so check, start from this serotyping. Or you can go zone wise, that is you are living in which area, which bacteria usually being isolated, so you can start from there. So after the culture, after the isolation, the second week is for the antibodies testing. And how we do that is with the help of Vidal test. Now what is this Vidal test? It's a very, very old test, and it is the most widely used serological test. It is the tube agglutination test, that is based on the principle of tube agglutination. And what we are doing in this test, that is we are detecting the antibodies which have been formed against the somatic antigen O and the flagellar antigen H. This antibody to somatic antigen O is almost same in all the, because what we are detecting, we are detecting somewhere typhi, paratyphi A or paratyphi B. So the antigen is same on all the three. So therefore when we are testing, we put a single line, single row of only one this O antigen, because it is same in all the three serotypes. But the flagellar antigen is specific for each serotype. So we have to put three rows of H antigen, that is one is of typhi, one is of paratyphi A, and other is of the paratyphi B. So we put four rows for testing the Vidal test. So as I have told you that patient serum contain antibodies to salmonella antigen, and we are detecting that antibody level, also the level, that is the titer, by using the salmonella antigen. So what we do, we take the patient serum and we make the doubling dilution, we dilute the patient serum, and we make four set of like this. One set, like I have taken 6 or 7 test tubes and I have diluted the patient serum. Similarly, another row of 7 test tube, then third row, then fourth row. So like this you have to make 4 rows. Then you will add equal amount of, so whatever amount you have taken of the serum, equal amount you have to add the antigen. So one row you will mark the O row, that is of the O antigen, and which is common to all the three. So you will put only one row, and you will add equal amount of antigen all the test tube. Then comes the second row, TH row, that is for the Salmonatyphi H antigen. So this O antigen is blue colored in the kit we get, and this H antigen is pink in color. So this TH antigen will be added to the second row. Then AH is for third, so you will add this antigen to the third row. Then fourth row is for BH. So like this, you have to add the equal amount of antigen. Then we incubate this whole set in the water bath at 37 degrees Celsius for overnight, and next day we will do the reporting. So when we see if there is antigen, suppose the patient serum contains the antibody and you have added the antigen from outside. So there will be a reaction, agglutination reaction. So in case of O antigen, we get, if it is a positive, we get granular chalky clumps. It will be like chalk deposits. And in case of H agglutination, there will be large, loose, fluffy cotton, woolly clumps. So that is how we check. Then we have to check up till how much dilution we are getting the positive results. So if there is no reaction, so there will be button formation. So that all antigen will get settled down at the center of the test tube and it will form a button. So this you can see the slide agglutination. So there you are seeing O, that is blue color, then H pink, AH pink, BH pink. So these are the three H antigen, we have added this H antigen of a specific serotype, O is common. Then we also put one negative control and one positive control to check whether the test has been validate the test, whether the kit is working properly or all the steps have been performed correctly. If you are not getting the correct result in the controls, that means you have put the test wrong. So this is the slide agglutination test. In the test, usually the test tube method is being preferred. The slide method is not being preferred, test tube method, because there we get good results. And in test tube method, instead of doing it on the slide, we do it in the test tube and we put lot of dilutions there. So we are able to know the titer also. This is how, like they have shown only the O method, O, that is the blue color. So there they make the dilutions and you can see the first tube is positive, second tube is positive, third tube is positive, and then the in the fourth very little bit coming positive, then the this negative. So what titer we are getting, that is 1:160. This is how we make the doubling dilution. It start from, you can start from any range, like they have started from 10. So it's 20, 40, 80, that is the doubling dilution. So this is how we have to read the titer. So when we, how we can say whether the result is positive, negative. So it is a little bit typical to give the reporting. That is why most of the results, if not interpretation is not done in a right way, then you can get the false positive. And we have seen that because it belongs to the, it is a member of Enterobacteriaceae family, and it has been seen cross reactivity of the antigen of Salmonella with other Enterobacteriaceae member. Even if the person has had in the past the infection of Escherichia coli, in those patients even we have noticed the positive Vidal test. Also, like in the coronavirus also infection, it has been seen almost all the patients who were positive for the coronavirus, they all were giving the positive Vidal test. So it has been not a very good test until unless we are interpreting its results in a very good manner. So how we can check its results, that is depending upon the zone. Like if you are living in a certain area and there according to the place, there may be a baseline titer of these antibodies in the normal person. Means the person who does not have any infection of Salmonella they also have a certain level of antibodies that is called as a baseline titer of antibody in the normal person. So just by getting the agglutination reaction, we cannot say that Vidal test is positive. According to the area, according to the place, according to the endemicity of the disease, you have to know that the normal persons can have so much level of antibodies, and above this you can say it is positive. So mostly in India, for O we are giving positive for more than 100 and for H more than 200. But the ideally, if you want to report for Vidal test, then it is best said that go for the paired sera. What is paired sera? A patient comes to you and you have checked for the Vidal test and you get a certain titer. Then you ask the patient to come one or two week later, and there you will measure again the Vidal test, and if the titer has been raised to four-fold titer, that means the initial titer se wo four times badh gaya hai, so you can say that this is a case of positive Vidal test. So that is the ideal method. Other tests kya kya kar sakte hain? We have the TYFIDOT, that is also good test. It is a dot ELISA test and you can do in the first week also. That is the advantage of TYFIDOT, and it has a better result as compared to the Vidal. Then other tests are the ideal tubex test, IgM dipstick test, and detection of VI antibodies, that is for the carriers. Then antigen detection by ELISA and the coagglutination method, molecular methods by flagellin G, IROB, Flixi gene. Then certain non-specific tests are also there, that is the neutropenia, so they will be fall in the level of the neutrophil count. Then leukocytosis, so leukocyte count increased, and liver function test deranged, that is the altered level of the enzymes of the liver enzymes. Now comes a treatment, that is the empirical treatment. Empirical treatment means which you have to give once a patient reach to you and you have just sent the sample but you have not got the reports. So for empirical treatment, you start ceftriaxone or alternatively azithromycin. Once you got the result, then if the patient is fully susceptible to all the drugs, that is sensitive to all the drugs, you can give ciprofloxacin. Alternatively, if it is there is some reason you cannot give, then you can give amoxicillin, chloramphenicol, or the cotrimoxazole. MDR stain, if the patient is resistant to the three drugs, that is amoxicillin, chloramphenicol, cotrimoxazole, then you can give the ciprofloxacin, ceftriaxone, azithromycin. Then NAR strain, that is the patient is resistant to the nalidixic resistant strain, so you have to give the ceftriaxone or azithromycin. For carrier, so those persons who are carrying the this bacteria, so you have to give ampicillin or amoxicillin along with the probenecid for 6 weeks. Now how we can control the reservoir, that is the cases or the carriers? In case of cases, early diagnosis hona chahiye and early treatment. Stool and urine has to be disinfected with 5% Crisol. Follow up mein you have to check stool and urine culture ki whether the patient is excreting the bacteria or not. So at 3 to 4 months, and second is 12 months. Then carriers, we need stool or urine culture. The second is the VI antibodies. Now what are the preventive measures? Hand washing, basic sanitation, promotion for the food hygiene, purification of drinking water, health education. So it is very important the patient, person should know from there where they can get the infection. So proper basic hygiene things, if they know, then we can prevent these infections. Thanking you for